Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting live from our studios in New York City. And I'd like to welcome all the people, all the syndicated programs and stations that carry us. If you're listening live over a listening device like a portable cell phone, or you're downloading this right now because you're listening at night, we're here to empower people. And you're going to see a lot of empowerment in this hour. We always start with the latest on health and healing, which is a universally appreciated topic. How can we live a longer life? We're going to talk about that because from the Salk Institute, there's new research about how a particular nutrient has very strong anti-aging abilities. I'll share that. Also, fresh fish oil lowers diabetes risks. This is from the University of Auckland, which is in New Zealand. And from the University of Illinois, omega-3 fatty acid fights inflammation via the cannabinoids. I've talked a lot about the cannabinoids. I'll talk more about that today. And also, I've been advocating for a long time that if you have a stroke or brain injury, immediately get hyperbaric oxygen therapy. In fact, there was a gentleman, his name's Mike from Connecticut, used to attend some of the health support groups back in the 1980s and 90s, and he actually carried with him a little note saying, if I'm ever put into a medically compromised position where I cannot advocate for myself, contact Gary Null. I didn't even know this. So I get a call one day, and he had had a stroke, and he was not responding. And so I said, give him hyperbaric, and the doctor was arguing with me. And I said, he's given me legal power. I'm saying I want him to have oxygen therapy. And they didn't want to do it, but I told him I would sue them if they didn't. And they did. It saved his life. In fact, he wrote me a long letter saying that it because of that, he didn't have this side effects afterwards, because hyperbaric oxygen therapy helps protect the brain cells from being destroyed from a stroke. Even, get this, even 5 years after a stroke, it can still help you. And yet it's not universally used. There is science supporting all of its uses. Now, yes, if you have burns, they'll put you in hyperbaric. If you had the bends from being deep water, submerged and, let's say, diving, that will help you as well. But there are myriad conditions that will help, including damage to the brain. I'm going to share this particular study. It's out of Louisiana State University and their Health Science Center, and I'll quote it verbatim, just a few paragraphs. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy reverses brain damage in a drowned toddler. And it goes on to talk about how this whole clinical professor and director of the hyperbaric medicine at the Louisiana State University of Health down in New Orleans, in the New Orleans School of Medicine, they got this young girl, quote, the two-year-old girl experienced cardiac arrest, that means a heart attack, and after a cold water drowning accident in a swimming pool. After resuscitation at Arkansas Children's Hospital, MRIs revealed deep gray matter injury and cerebral atrophy with gray and white matter loss. She had no speech, no responsiveness to commands, with constant squirming and head shaking at the hospital discharge, meaning she was she had no cognition. She was just moving. The body was as if it were in spasm or going through seizures, but she could not hear anyone speak, and for all intents and purposes, that would have been considered the end. She had been brain damaged and put on some form of sedative, and ultimately she would have passed. And then it says that the doctor was consulted, and because hyperbaric oxygen therapy was not available at the patient's location, he began a bridging treatment to prevent permanent tissue degeneration until he could get the patient to a hyperbaric treatment center. Then talked about that. And then here's what he says, quote, 55 days post-drowning, he began short-duration treatments with 100% hyperbaric for 45 minutes twice a day through a nasal canal. The patient became more alert, awake, and stopped squirming. Her rate of neurological improvement increased with where she was able to laugh, increase movements of her arms and hands, and grasp with the left hand, partial oral feeding, eye tracking, and short sequencing of speech, pre-drowning speech level, but with diminished vocabulary. Then it says, the patient and family then traveled to New Orleans, where 78 days post-drowning, this is over 2.5 months later, the doctor, Harch, began treating her with hyperbaric oxygen therapy, and for 45 minutes a day, 5 days a week, for 40 sessions. At the beginning of each session, the patient showed visually apparent and physical examination documented neurological improvement. After 10 of these sessions, the patient's mother reported that her daughter was, quote, near normal, except for gross motor function. And then she continued the therapy and she regained complete normalcy. That's what is possible. Now, here's what we have to understand. The average hospital, the average physician will not know to use this. So you should educate yourself. Get a simple composition of all the scientific literature on neurological damage, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's, ALS, stroke, and put this into a document and just carry it with you. So if you should ever have a problem, you can request hyperbaric oxygen therapy, and it's in most hospitals. And even though they normally wouldn't use it for any of those conditions, insist upon it. And that way, you know you have a chance of improving neurologically and saving your life. I've seen a lot of people benefit from hyperbaric oxygen therapy. I mean, a lot, especially people who've had Parkinson's. I would see people with Parkinson's getting hyperbaric 4 days a week for about an hour. Can completely change them. This is from the University of Illinois. This was published by the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. That's our most respected scientific body in America. Here's what it says. Chemical compounds called cannabinoids are found in marijuana and also are produced naturally in the body from omega-3 fatty acids. A well-known cannabinoid is marijuana, and it's responsible for some of the euphoric effects, but it also has anti-inflammatory benefits. A new study in animal tissue reveals the cascade of chemical reactions that convert the omega-3 fatty acids into cannabinoids that have anti-inflammatory benefits, but without any psychotropic high. Foods such as eggs and fish and nuts contain the omega-3 fatty acids and the omega-6 fatty acids, which the body converts into these endocannabinoids that the body produces naturally. And this is where the benefits come from. And guess who was doing this work since 1964? The Israeli chemist Raphael Meshulam was the first to discover and isolate THC from marijuana to test whether he had found the compound that produces euphoria. And then he did the original work. So they have known, according to this report, for a long time that the cannabinoids are helpful. Now, I'm going to give you three different points of view. One, for medical use, there's more than 22,000 studies in the peer-reviewed literature on the medicinal benefits of the cannabinoids, but that's not the same as the marijuana that a person smokes. It doesn't produce any of the hallucinogens, uses a different pathway in the body. And my personal oversight of individuals who have had strokes, who have multiple seizures, including children with autism spectrum disorder, when they're getting medical cannabinoids from a physician in a state where it is legal and they use it as directed, it's nothing less than phenomenal. There is no medicine, there is no medical technology that can begin to even do 1% of what it does. And it's harmless. There's no safety issue. So when you have people who are coming at this issue politically or ideologically and say, we believe that it's dangerous, it has to stay a class one drug, which is the most toxic of all drugs, and therefore people should be put into prison, that's all wrong. It should be completely decriminalized. But I am one of those people who believe that all drugs should be decriminalized, and therefore you eliminate the mafia and the organized crime and the drug cartels and the profiteering and the people committing crimes in order to support their habits. And you protect the victims that otherwise would be there. You protect people's lives who would be used to transport like the mules. You would save hundreds of billions of dollars, taxpayers' dollars, by not looking at this as a disease, but rather looking at this as bad choices. Now let's help the person deal with what they felt was missing in their life, that they would have to do this and get them off of this in such a way that they cleanse and detoxify the body. Why? Because part two is that if you're a daily regular user of marijuana, it can create delusional psychoses and paranoia. Now, much of the literature rightly shows that this is transient, and many people it is. But I happen to have two friends that it was not transient, and they were not able to function in any meaningful way for over 30 years of their life. One just passed last year in Hawaii. He was a friend of mine since I came to New York City, a close personal friend. And as his son said, he can't put his father in any situation because he's paranoid and think people are spying on him. And another person who I know would tear up their mattress and say they felt someone was planting bugs in the mattress. Once you go down that path of having uncontrolled paranoid delusions, there's just no place in society you're going to be able to fit and have a family, have good quality relationships, or have work. So we need to understand that for many people, marijuana creates brain damage that can be permanent. But also, here's something that simply will not sink in. No matter what I'm saying, it will do no good at all. Marijuana, smoking marijuana, is multiple times more potent as a carcinogen than cigarettes. You have to remember, you're taking chemicals into your body that create high levels of inflammatory cytokines, and that can precipitate cancer, including lung cancer. So understand this is part of what happens. And yet, I fully believe that all drugs should be legalized and medical marijuana should be a routine, everyday usage for those who would benefit from it. So that's why it's a little complicated. It's almost always black and white, but it's not black and white. The science is all good. The emptying out our prisons of people who are in there for drug use, that should be a no-brainer. And to be able to help people get back their lives without stigmatizing them and shaming them, that should be something we do because we care about other human beings. Just want to share that with you. Now, fish oil lowers diabetes rate in this study done at the University of Auckland, which is in New Zealand. And here's what it says. It says, fresh fish oil given to overweight pregnant, in this case rats, prevented their offspring from developing a major diabetes risk. And so just imagine what fish oil could do for you. We know it does several things. But you can also get the same thing from walnut oil, from eating walnuts, or from flaxseed oil. You protect your heart. You protect the lining of your arteries. You protect your brain. You turn off inflammation in the brain. That can help prevent dementia, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, ALS. One of the contributing factors is inflammation in all those conditions, and it tampers down inflammation. It helps your joints. It helps lessen heart attack and strokes. Another reason to use it. And finally, this is an important study from the Salk Institute. More anti-aging effects from fisetin. Here's what it says. That they have found potential anti-aging effects of fisetin, F-I-S-E-T-I-N, a compound found in plants. Now, which plants? Many of you are using these plants. Either you're eating them fresh, you're eating them organic frozen, thawing them out, you're taking the concentrates. I haven't seen a strawberry concentrate, but grapes certainly and apples are concentrates. Or most powerful and best of all, you're taking them in compounded powders. Because the powder started off as the fruit was juice, the powder, the juice then is 97% water. You remove the water, you're left with 3% that was powerful. So here's what it says. The fisetin is in strawberries, grapes, one of the most perfect foods you can take, apples, onions, and cucumbers. And this was published in the Journal of Gerontology, Series A, and this is from researchers from the Salk Institute. Reported a reduction in aging-related inflammation and cognitive decline in this study. So we've already seen scientific literature that shows that there's a decrease in memory loss, meaning you have less memory loss when you have fisetin foods. So now let's go full circle. We now know from over at least 2,000 studies in the scientific literature, quality studies, many of them long-term studies, that you reduce your risk of all diseases and reduce your risk of premature mortality or death by sometimes up to 7 to 10 years when you increase the daily servings of fruits and vegetables. And when you even go to a plant-based diet, you increase it even more, meaning you're going to live a longer life, a healthier life, less disease, less obesity, diabetes, when you're on a healthy plant-based diet. Meaning you're having the different nuts, pistachios and almonds and walnuts and cashews, and you're eating all the gourds and the seasonal vegetables and root vegetables, rutabaga, parsnips, persimmons. Not persimmons, that's a fruit, but the squashes, sweet potatoes and yams. And beans, legumes are so powerful. They're very rich in protein. But they have fiber, so the protein isn't toxic to the liver and kidneys. You're not getting urea and ammonium from having lentils or dal soup or split peas as you would if you had a hamburger or a steak. And so longer life, less heart attack, less stroke, thinning of the blood, which is what you want, and less inflammation, all because you're not getting the arachidonic acid from meat and the saturated fats from meat products, you're getting the healthy fats. And you're also now, according to this study from the Salk Institute, you're getting anti-aging nutrients. So let's just say that you've been living your normal life, but for the last, maybe you've been listening for 10 years or 20 years. Some of you, a gentleman last night said he's been listening to me, started listening to me when I used to sub-host on Joan Hamburger Show, and I'd be on some of the John Gambling Show and other shows on WR before I went to WMCA. That goes back to the early 70s. And he said, "How old am I, Gary?" So I looked at him, and I said, "Well, if you're asking me the question, then it means that I should not be able to guess it. But I'm looking at your skin around your neck. I'm looking at your hands, I'm looking at the thinning of your lips, I'm looking at the coloration of your eyes and whether or not your skin is tight, I'm looking at the quality of your hair and your muscle mass. These are things that you would look at if you were trying to determine someone's health. And I'm going to say that you're about 50 to 55. He says, I'm 81. 81? I was absolutely shocked. "You're kidding." "No," he said, "I'm 81 years of age. He's, "But you know something? When my family thought I was stupid and a health nut, and they thought you somehow were this crazy guy, you know, promoting these quackery items of exercising and stress management and yoga and taking your supplements every day, like vitamin C and and vitamin D. I did all that. I became a vegan the first time I heard you, and I exercised. I did all the stuff I was supposed to do. Well, what I noticed, Gary, is every time I go to a high school reunion, other people either didn't show up because they were dead or too sick to attend. And I began at one point, by my 40th high school reunion, I began to look like I was the son, if I was the son and instead of the father. I didn't have anything I could associate because nobody wanted to hear what I was doing. And he said, I just stopped going. He said, but I just want you to know it works. Now, think if you've been using a diet that emphasizes lots of fruits and vegetables and fresh juices, you'd be younger also, less susceptible to disease. And that's what we want. My goal is to have you live a long and healthy and happy life. And it's not difficult. Difficulty is being honest about every choice you make and knowing there's a high probability of a good outcome if you make good choices. The difficulty in life is when we have to justify bad choices and start having to come exclusively from our defense mechanisms, our ego, become aggressive and saying, I don't need to do this, I'm not going to do that, I don't care about this. Yeah, then you got to live with the fact you're not living in your own best interest. That's hard. Health, easy. Not health, hard. That's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null. We're going to take a short break and come right back. We have a lot to share today. Please stay with us. Sometimes we forget about the simple messages that can have profound impact on how we think. We get caught up into routines and ritualizing our life, doing something because it's Sunday morning and something else because it's Tuesday evening and it's bowling this night and eating this way that night. We have to break some habits. And to do that, sometimes we just need simple words to emphasize how we could think differently. Here's a little thought about what it means to be normal. And this is a short segment. It's only about 3.5 minutes long. It's just loading up. We'll be right where. And then I'm going to talk about healing AIDS naturally. All new information. Some really good stuff. So you won't want to miss that. Because not that you have AIDS, but you may know someone who does, and you could share that information with them. No, okay, we're going to hold on that. We're having it's taking its time loading. So I'm going to go right now. This segment I'm sharing with you today is called Healing AIDS Naturally. And we're also going to be playing, for those of you who are watching this, which you can watch later in the day to see the video stream, I'm going to show you a little PowerPoint presentation I've made. Why? Because there are a bunch of us. I'm thinking of maybe 4,000 people, including multiple scientists, Nobel Prize winners, gay activists, gay publishers like Charles Ortlieb, and outstanding reporters within the gay community like Nina Ostrom, and at least a dozen other reporters I've met, and physicians who believe that we should take a different approach to the subject of AIDS. Yes, AIDS is 30 different conditions. And when you look at those conditions, whether it's Kaposi's sarcoma or pneumocystis carinii pneumonia or thrush, those are real conditions. And a lot of people have suffered from these conditions. The question then is it what the orthodox medical and scientific community tells us should be the only way of determining the legitimacy of the diagnosis and then the treatment? We should have a drug treatment only. Let's say AZT. Well, I was the first reporter that I'm aware of in the United States to actually believe everything that we were being told. And then a person came into my office and handed me a whole giant stack of documents. This person was the overseer, the supervisor of the AZT, the first drug to treat AIDS, study. And she said, it's a total fraud. I said, what do you mean? She said, well, people who died by taking AZT were excluded from the study. and people would pull their tablets together, and if it was sweet, they knew that was a placebo, and they threw those away because nobody wanted the placebo. They all believed that AZT would work. And she said, I've reported here my letters to the top person at the FDA and my supervisor at the FDA, showing them this is a fraudulent study. This drug does not have any legitimate basis for being considered safe or effective. But the politics had already superseded the legitimacy of the science. And as a result, everybody lined up to take the drug. Now, up until that point, I was working with an awful lot of people who had AIDS-defining illnesses and had been working with the leading gay physician in New York, or one of the leading gay physicians in America, Dr. Stephen Chiesa. And he had been working with me since the mid-1970s, when he was seeing in a small portion of the gay community, as well as I was seeing in a small portion of the heterosexual community, those most active in the sexual revolution, and both of them had something in common, a high use of amyl nitrite, or poppers, which could temporarily, for a few seconds, extend the sexual pleasure of whatever they were doing. But I was seeing people had multiple sexually transmitted diseases, getting syphilis and hepatitis and herpes and all kinds of diseases, and they'd take their antibiotics and overcome most of these and then go right back to partying. But mind you, we have to understand at the height of the sexual revolution, only about 3% of heterosexuals ever participated in it. You would think everybody was, but it wasn't. People were watching it, reading about it, but only a tiny fraction actually participated. That was also true within the gay community. 97% of gays did not participate in the fast-track lifestyles, doing the drugs and the multiple sexual partners, unprotected sex, taking amyl nitrate and cocaine and other drugs. 97% had nothing to do with that. But you wouldn't have known that. So I brought both of these together and saw there were certain common factors, and then I gave him protocols that would help reverse that, and that's why he kept working with me. He sent me hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of his patients, and I worked with them and got them back their health, especially if they agreed to change their lifestyle so that sex was not the problem, but having unprotected sex and taking drugs and amyl nitrate and drinking and staying up all night, that destroys your immune system. I don't care if you're an Olympic athlete. You live that lifestyle every night. In a year, you're going to be in a hospital and dying. In any case, what really turned it for me was all these documents showing up by this whistleblower. And then I reviewed this. And then when I started to ask questions, I was getting stonewalled everywhere. People were saying, no, it's just one virus can do all this and it has nothing to do with your lifestyle. Everyone's equally vulnerable. And one guy even said, if you were a nun in Oklahoma that was a virgin, you're as equal in your capacity to get AIDS as anyone else. Well, of course, none of that was true, but we wanted to believe it because it was politically correct to believe it. We shouldn't have believed it. We should have questioned, and some did. One of the leading scientists in the world, the man who won the Nobel Prize in chemistry for discovering the PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, Professor Kerry Mullis. You will have an opportunity to see what he said to me in an interview while we were walking on the beach in front of his home, then in his home, about all when he tried to look for the science behind this. So understand, AIDS is real. AIDS conditions are real. People can get sick and die from it. But how to treat it and how to know you have the right diagnosis, because who patented the diagnosis? Robert Gallo. And so we questioned. We had legitimate questions, but you weren't allowed to question. The moment you began to question anything about AIDS, who was making the profit, which organizations and individuals had aligned themselves with the maker of AZT, Burroughs Wellcome, and how many millions of dollars, it would turn out to be hundreds of millions of dollars, they were spreading around. And once you spread money around, you find people become silent about being critical. That's true in any field. And I had just spent 10 years exposing the whole cancer industry. The work ended up on 60 Minutes and on 2020. Won two Emmys on 2020 on the case of Dr. Stanislaw Brzezinski, and I brought that to the Americans' attention, that this man was being persecuted who had alternative therapies that were working, and why. Why didn't they want a non-toxic natural approach by this brilliant MD, PhD? Why didn't they want that to become public knowledge? Well, anyhow, a whole series of articles, television specials, and we broke down that door to show that the war on cancer was really about profiteering, fraud, and lies. Cancer was real, but how they were deeming the right treatment was not. I even confronted Dr. Jury, who was the head of the National Cancer Institute, and he agreed that politics was rampant within it, and there should be more research on natural approaches, and there had been in the 1940s. But be that as it may, when I started writing my first articles about challenging the politics and profiteering within the AIDS community, I was approached one day by a person who I will not name at this time, and he said, "You don't want to open this door, Gary. You don't want to open it." I said, "Why not?" He's because these people are not going to be thwarted in their efforts. It's all about the hundreds of billions of dollars they can make. And they're buying off people, they're buying off organizations, and even those organizations they're not buying off, they're able to influence politically, ideologically. He said, so keep with other battles. And that's just not my nature. So I wrote a series of articles, and I saw the pushback. Now, mind you, there were no other journalists. Celia Farber came later, John Lauritsen came later. But I began to write extensively. I began to produce programs. I began to have gay activists on and physicians on showing what AIDS really was and how to treat it. So my whole energy was on how to help people with AIDS naturally, not with AZT, because suddenly the death rate from AIDS just skyrocketed directly in proportion to who was using AZT. Now, here's the reality. We were right then. Today, any physician in America using AZT 1,600 milligrams a day would lose their license to practice medicine. But at that time, that's what they were taking. They would be told to get up, take their 300 or 400 milligrams every 4 hours. And then when I saw the people dying on one side who otherwise weren't dying, they may have been HIV positive, but they weren't dying, now they were dying. And a person came to me and said that his partner just died, and he was on AZT, and the partner had HIV, but he had chosen, he had listened to me on the radio, and he was a vegetarian, and he was doing fine. And he said, the world should know about this. And that's when I did my first documentary called The AIDS, The Real Heroes. And in that documentary, you will see dozens of individuals who had full-blown AIDS, who took natural approaches. I think six of them took mine. And the rest took other approaches to cleaning up their body, antiviral and antibacterial and anti-yeast, the herbs and medications, and they regained their health. And when you see the documentary, it's very heartwarming to see people in their journey. And we even got them all together, and they were each telling their story. One was a psychiatrist and about the role of stress when you got a diagnosis. It's supposed to be a death sentence, and you begin to believe that and how that changes your life. So anyway, I did that documentary, and then they started coming up with this. If you say anything, anything that disagrees with controlling the war on AIDS, you're an AIDS denier. Oh, you mean like a Holocaust denier? That was the idea. Make people look bad, even if they're right and the people doing the condemning are wrong. So I want to show you what we did and what I did. First and foremost, I personally work with 1,200 people with full-blown AIDS at the Tri-State Healing Center. And these 1,200 individuals with full-blown AIDS were not charged. I paid for it. And I asked the people who would come in the evenings, they wanted to be kind of together so they could have their own support system, so they would come from like 5 o'clock until midnight, 7 hours. And there'd be dozens in there every night, and 7 nights a week. The center would open 8 in the morning, close at midnight. And the doctors weren't for free. We had a whole team of medical doctors, nurses, and the therapies were extremely expensive, but they weren't burdened by that. And I said, who would like to go on a fast track, a really advanced protocol? And 12 people said yes. And so I gave them a special protocol. And to this day, we are not aware of anyone else in the world that has cured every person in that protocol, which happened. And along the way, and that took about 16 months, of 5 days a week, 4 hours a day, they were getting special therapies because they got long drips. that would take hours, and homeopathic zeolites and juicing and bitter melon and all kinds of therapies. In any case, when they tested, and we had the best quality blood labs testing them, and you could just see the viral titers going down, 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 and then nothing. And tested HIV negative. Along comes Stokely Carmichael, and he was interested in helping some of the people he knew who had AIDS. And at that time, he wasn't sick. Later, he would come back because he himself was sick, not with AIDS. And he said, we got to get this information out. And then there was a reporter, he was a columnist. He would write for the Amsterdam News, Doug Henderson, African-American male, a lawyer. And he wrote a series of articles saying, why don't we know this? How are these people in this center getting well and other places they're just dying? And then in comes a request for me to lecture at the Apollo Theater. And I said, fine, I lecture all the time. I went up there. It was packed. There were so many people, they had to do it multiple days. And a group of black physicians came up to meet with me. And they wanted to know the therapy. I gave them the protocols. They came down and worked. They didn't actually work. They came down and observed how it was being implemented. And then Bill Tatum, the publisher of the Amsterdam News, the leading black newspaper in New York City, if not the country, came. And he came over and over and over to look to see, looking at records, talking with patients. And he sent a report, and they did a whole story. And then that story got picked up by Tony Brown, the African-American commentator on PBS, who had the largest syndication, about 400 shows on PBS. And he called me. He said, are you getting good results with AIDS? I said, we are. And he said, I'm going to send someone over. So for the next several months, and if you're looking at your screen, that's Tony Brown's journal on PBS. That's me on the air 8 times over 2 years with people who had complete elimination of their disease. They were absolutely positively cured. So the entire African-American community was being exposed through articles, through leading spokespersons, through Tony Brown's journal, through the Amsterdam News. So if you talked about AIDS, they knew the story. And we were flooded with people wanting more information from the African-American community from all over the world. The health minister of the Sudan called, and the health minister of Uganda called, could I send the protocols? And people like Neville Hodgkinson of the Sunday Times of London, the most respected publication, newspaper in the world. And so we were flooded with people wanting to know, thousands of people, and scientists and physicians. And we shared everything. You wouldn't know this. So finally, we had such good results that we spent a year and we put together a press conference. And the press conference was called AIDS is Not a Death Sentence. And we sent 7,000 invitations out 3 times. I hired at $5,000 a PR firm, and we sent it out. Now there, if you're looking at the screen later today, not right now, we're filming it, but you'll see a panel of physicians, board-certified physicians and scientists. You'll see David Patterson, who was Senator Patterson at the time, and he would later become governor of David Patterson. There's one of the people. In fact, that's the one who said that he had his roommate who took AZT and died. But we had everyone in that room had at one time full-blown AIDS, and they had their physicians with them, and they were improving tremendously, all using different natural non-toxic therapies. And 8 of the people in that room, of the 100 that had assembled, were people I'd personally worked with who had completely reversed AIDS and were vitally healthy. Now, here's what you have to understand. There was a campaign to tell every journalist and every AIDS organization, every gay organization, don't you attend. And so no one did. When I say no one, I mean no one attended the press conference. But here are people I'd worked with for a long period of time. You're seeing the pictures of the press conference. There's the press conference. There's a panel of scientists. There are people with their doctors. And yet they'll try to tell you this doesn't exist. And if you're not seeing this information, if you're not reading this information, if you're not watching the video on that press conference that went on for 8 hours, you would not know that that exists. Now, there I am at the podium and talking about my protocols. So then a year later, I found all these doctors around the world who are saying they're getting phenomenal results. So I flew them in on my dime from Japan and China. And I rented the largest church I could find outside of St. John the Divine. I rented the one on Weston Avenue, on Center Park West. There it is. Now, up there, you're seeing right there in that moment, four different leading scientists, top scientists and medical doctors, talking about what they know, what they're using, herbs or botanicals or biochemical, but nothing toxic. And it went all day. It went from morning until late at night, and 1,600 people showed up, mainly people who were interested, lots of gays, lots of people that we'd work with and their family members or others to support the fact that there was a natural, non-toxic approach to AIDS. There's the actual proof, the actual all-day and all-night conference with about 14 to 16 speakers, because two of the speakers didn't have enough time to really get it in because they were later in the evening. So they stayed outside and gave a whole impromptu discussion outside till over midnight. So we had a press conference. Cured people, no one came. We had an all-day conference on natural approaches from around the world with scientists. Nobody came. Then I wrote a textbook on AIDS called AIDS is Second Opinion. And this AIDS is Second Opinion, and you're looking at the publisher, who's a very liberal publisher, Seven Stories Press, was so concerned because of the people who were supporting AZT and the drugs and the big pharma threatened him. So he, you know, don't give any misinformation. So he hired Professor Jim Feast, an outstanding academic who came in and was responsible for verifying every single fact. Well, guess what the largest chapter in the book is? Over 136 pages is natural therapies. Right there, nutritional and lifestyle changes. Over 3,700 references to the scientific literature. So there we have the different natural approaches to, from the textbook, 700-page textbooks. I went on to do five more documentaries. I also did 27 articles, including the longest article in the history of the Towns Letter for Doctors and Patients, on true stories of people using natural therapies and reversing AIDS. And they had never accepted an article that long in their history. I did many. Then you also have resources, and I'm posting resources. Then it wasn't just me and being attacked because I was actually curing people, and they were killing people. They were diseasing people by their drugs, and Big Pharma was profiting from it. But the media would not come and see the truth. The media, the New York Times. In fact, the New York Post, just before the press conference, a week before, this reporter shows up from the New York Post, and I'm at the Roosevelt Hotel in the Grand Ballroom. The place is packed. It's only standing room only. There were 1,600 people there, and I was talking about disease, and the reporter said, you know, who are these people? I said, these are people who want to know about healthy, natural approaches to disease. I said, fine. I said, how many people in the room, this is a reporter, how many here have had disease that no longer have it, heart disease, cancer, diabetes, and all these hands went up. Everybody, how many have improved? I said, so why ask me questions when you've got 1,600 people here you can question? How many people in the room are physicians or PhDs or nurses? At least 80 hands went up. I said, now there's a physician who had a disease, used natural therapies, and no longer is diseased. Why don't you interview them? Well, no, you know. And they were more interested in supporting the quackbusters. And I said, oh, you mean this discredited guy who has no degrees in nutrition, no PhDs, and hasn't practiced medicine for a long time? Just ask him why he hasn't practiced medicine and why he feels he can talk in a field that he has no expertise. By the way, he was completely debunked, but not before the people in the AIDS community use his material and put it up on Wikipedia to smear anybody as an AIDS denier. So we saw that the New York Post, little veracity there, they didn't want to know the truth. And I said, I'm having a press conference. You can meet all these people who've reversed AIDS or improved their condition. Of course, they didn't show up. So on the one hand, when you have the truth of how to help a condition like AIDS, and nobody wants to show up and nobody wants that truth, but everybody's behind you if you want to sell them a toxic drug that can kill you, what in the hell does that say about us as a society? The fraud, the duplicity, the compromise within the AIDS community, it is palpable. Now I put a chart up here, and this chart shows that I'm no longer alone. There's 2,900 activists, physicians, multiple Nobel Prize winners. See that 2,952 doubters. They're not doubting AIDS. Nobody doubts AIDS. They're doubting how it's treated, just like there are people who doubt chemotherapy and radiation and statin drugs for heart disease and Prozac for depression. Yeah, they're legitimate doubters. But when you doubt it with AIDS, you're suddenly smeared. Well, why don't you take on the Nobel Prize winners and Department of Virology professionals? Because we're not alone. And so I want you to know that the next time you hear someone say, oh, you know, Gary and all these other people are just AIDS deniers. No. Gary Null has done what you've never done. Gary Null has done what no one else in the whole world has done. No one in the AIDS community has done. We've healed people with full-blown AIDS, and we have the science to back it up, the blood chemistries to back up. What do you have outside of profiting off of it? So we're posting this today. Download it. How big is it? Oh, I'm guesstimating about 6,000 pages of material. And quoting, we have quotes from those 2,800 people. And you'll see Nobel Prize winner in chemistry several times. And they're offering legitimate challenges. Since when are you not allowed to question how a disease is treated? That's medical fascism. We're supposed to be a nation of democracy and freedom of choice. In AIDS, that doesn't exist. Now let's go over and say hello to Charles Ortel. He is on the line now. He is a former Wall Street banker, having been a managing director of Dillard Reed and Newport Value Partners. He did a blog exposing the Clinton Foundation, and it can be found at charlesortel.com. And he also is a graduate of Yale and Harvard. Nice to have you with us today, Charles.
Well, thanks for having me on, Gary, and I really enjoyed the listening to the beginning there because it's directly relevant to the Clinton Foundation.
Tell us how.
The Clinton Foundation goes around, and in particular in the various political campaigns, taking credit for bringing down the price of HIV/AIDS drugs and of offering treatment around the world to people, particularly in the desperately poor parts of the world, where the problem still rages. And the truth of it is, Gary, I mean, if you were to look at the actual filings the way I have, or read some of the reports that are up on my site, what you'll see will horrify you, because you know very well just how dangerous these drugs are. And there's one company called Ranbaxy, R-A-N-B-A-X-Y, which is a despicable manufacturer of generic medicines that basically entered into an agreement with Bill Clinton and the Clinton Foundation in 2003, in October of 2003, to promote the sale of its products. And scroll forward to February, to Valentine's Day 2006, there was an FBI raid of numerous facilities around Boxy here in the United States. It took 7 years for the wheels of justice to turn, but in the end, Ranbaxy paid a $500 million fine and had to admit that they had not tested a single one of their drugs that were sold anywhere in the world prior to August 2004, and that subsequent test results were fabricated. And in essence, they were distributing adulterated HIV/AIDS medicines to poor people around the world. The issue is not simply, I'm not a medical person, but the issue is not simply the drug itself, but Ranbaxy also had a division that made the active pharmaceutical ingredient that went into multiple formulations of these generic drugs. And all these things, many of them, were adulterated. And you know, it's one thing to do treatment at Lenox Hill Hospital or New York Hospital where, you know, your patient base in the main is nourished well, is healthy, is, you know, affluent on the world scale. It's yet another to be distributing these pills in remote portions of Africa, in places where there is no electricity, so you can't, you know, you can't store these medicines properly. And there are no roads, there are no doctors, there are no nurses, there's no nothing. And also where the tests that are used in the United States for this, I understand to be, you know, pretty good at ferreting out whether you are or are not HIV positive, but the tests protocols that are used in the poorest countries of the world are lax, and they don't have the same precision, and the people that they're testing are malnourished. and could have other issues. So it's much tougher to be sure of the diagnosis. And then, as you rightly point out, some of those medicines in particular do the greatest damage to African people. The Caucasians have different reactions to the medicines. And, this is something that the truth is that many donors around the world, you can see it from the work that I've done, gave a lot of money to the Clinton Foundation. And the Clinton Foundation was not organized properly to do this work. It never validly obtained authorization from the IRS to engage in international work of any kind, let alone this complex stuff of treating not simply first-line patients, which is, the adult people who can take the medicine, but focusing on children, which is a really dangerous thing. If you misdiagnose that, you're really an evil person, and second-line patients. So you would understand better than I the many defects in the public filings of the Clinton Foundation in their supposed quest to fight HIV/AIDS. Unlike you, who, it's amazing that you've been able to reverse full-blown AIDS, they elide the question of whether you have HIV or AIDS. They go around saying they're curing AIDS when, in fact, what they're doing is they're just arresting the onset of full-blown AIDS by some of the medicines that they provide. So, somebody like you who really understands this issue could do a great service pouring through their actual disclosures and debunking them.
I will be happy to do that. Thank you for that. I didn't know that. Charles, I'm concerned that the American media is focusing all of its energy, as are virtually the entire liberal media, on that somehow Russia hacked the DNC and caused the election to fall into the favor of Trump. And I'm not a Trump supporter. I voted for Jill Stein. But what has happened is the Democrats have lost their way about providing legitimate issues that impact people. And one of the people who was out there telling us the truth, but the media wouldn't pick up on it, was a former British ambassador, Craig Murray, who publicly stated that the source of the WikiLeaks documents accusing the Democratic National Commission under the leadership of Debbie Wasserman Schultz was not the Russians, but a source within the Democratic Party. And so when we look at all the data and intelligence reports, it would seem convincingly evident that this is an inside leak. So please review with us the strongest evidence on hand that can either prove or disprove that concept.
Well, thanks for that question. That's a great question. So actually, in the last 24 hours, the renowned investigative journalist Seymour Hersh has come out to say that Seth Rich was the leaker. And, if you go back into the timeline, I don't have it right in front of me. I don't remember the date that WikiLeaks received the first dump, the DNC leaks. I forget whether that was April or May. But in that time frame, Hillary Clinton's campaign was not exactly unscarred. And there was a possibility, albeit it dimmed over time, that Bernie Sanders might upset her, which would have certainly humiliated the Clintons following the 2008 experience. So, who had the motive, who had the means, who had the opportunity to stop the additional damage? And, what is it, Occam's razor? The simplest explanation is the best one. I mean, it's clear to me that, that Debbie Wasserman Schultz was in the tank for the Clintons. It's clear to me that many others in the Democratic Party were in the tank for the Clintons. They spent an enormous amount of money. They would have been even more devastated had Bernie won the nomination. And so they had a clear motive. And, it's not as if Debbie Wasserman Schultz's behavior is the behavior you would imagine of an innocent person, supposedly facing down the D.C. police and telling them, don't go into certain places in the investigation. Now this stuff with the Pakistani IT group continuing to employ somebody at fancy compensation who was barred from using the House computers, that looks suspicious as hell. And if we're trying to think, what foreign government would have a motive to oppose, to like one person over another? I mean, here, the official story, of course, is that that we entered Pakistani territory and took out Osama bin Laden. There are a lot of people inside Pakistan, particularly in the ISI, the security service, who loved Osama bin Laden and would have been extremely upset about what we did. So you could easily imagine a decision by Pakistani government authorities to insert people into our very loose Washington, D.C. crowd who, you know, John Podesta is using a password of password, and others do not seem to be taking, you know, tough steps to protect their own computers. If we're going to have an investigation over government involvement, which I think we need to have, not restricted to Russia, we should be asking, you know, who are the various foreign governments that might have tried to interfere in our election? And for good measure, we should be asking, what has the United States done recently to potentially interfere in foreign referendums and elections? Because I don't think we have clean hands.
Well, I've reported on this program on numerous occasions. We have directly interfered since World War II in 81 separate elections around the world, in regime changes as well, to support those that we had a benefit in having our person in power. So we're the ones doing a lot of the regime change around the world. Also, we reported on this program that Seth, who was suspected, did this. In point of fact, he was killed, and he was shot twice, and they considered a simple, you know, robbery, and yet none of his jewelry was taken, his wallet wasn't taken, his wristwatch wasn't taken, nothing was taken. So that deserves to have its own investigation, because I believe that we're going to come to a conclusion that Bernie Sanders today would be president had this not occurred, had there had been an honest a Democratic convention, and he was the selected person, and he was certainly in a position to be selected instead of the dirty work that went on behind the scenes by Debbie Wasserman Schultz and the others, that there we would have a completely different world today and a different future for a lot of people. Your thoughts on what you believe the Clintons did and the Clintons group that they've had in power for a long time, the technocrats and the people who could really cause things to happen. What do you believe was their position in all this?
Well, I think the Clintons, you know, are wickedly smart people who saw that unregulated globalism presented an opportunity for politically connected cronies, not just at national level, but at multilateral level, to make enormous amounts of money illegally and stash it offshore. And they had willing partners in the academic crowd, which has benefited greatly from globalism, in the media craft, which after all needs to run these operations in many, many countries around the world, from investment types, you know, crooked and otherwise, from bankers, from, as you mentioned, big pharma, who are, you know, big contributors to campaigns and big beneficiaries of decisions that come out of governments around the world. So they saw this, and they put their people in place between 93 to 2001. Those people matured and now run, you know, many of these multilateral organizations, many of the big universities. And so as you, when you raise legitimate questions, as you said, about the HIV/AIDS issue, you're immediately attacked by these insiders as being outside the mainstream, uncredentialed, you know, making wild-ass conspiracy theories, when in fact, you know, the real conspiracy theory is the one ongoing, to have globalists rule the earth with unchecked, no regulation. And I think you're around the world seeing people wake up and saying, we don't like the smell of this coffee.
Final question. When you look at all the people who could benefit in the media and companies to be a part of a campaign, we're seeing it now with Trump and the people that he's associated with, these billionaires and a lot of the people in the deep state. We saw it with Bush. We saw it also with Halliburton, with Cheney, and we also saw it with Obama. Which ones should really be focused on, because we know we're not going to get an honest assessment or investigation from those media or corporations because their close association with Clinton's?
Well, actually, you know, what I found, and I'm not a journalist, but what I found is that, you know, shows like yours and these independent bloggers, I mean, one in particular, Patrick Halley, is the one who broke the Seymour Hersh thing just recently, people who have been trained and credentials, know how to write and know how to do proper analysis, but then go out on their own. Zero Hedge, for example, are places where you're going to get to the truth a lot more quickly. The established media, the New York Times, CNN, to a certain extent even Fox, they're heavily dependent on advertising revenue at a time when those revenues are going to other formats. So, you know, they're shrinking their investigative teams. They're not doing the kind of work you can do. and these independents are doing. So, In short, I would distrust the mainstream media across the political spectrum and focus on the facts that I can independently confirm, which are available in your show and other media outlets, independent media outlets.
Charles, we're out of time, but I'd like to do this. I'd like to invite you back for a full hour on our Progressive Commentary Hour to go into detail about the Clinton cash and the foundation, because that's also a story that has not been investigated officially by the government and should be. The Russian connection with their uranium, up to 20% of their uranium was purchased by a corporation in cooperation with Russia, and that was Hillary Clinton. And then right after that, they got a huge donation to the Clinton Foundation of over $100 million. And all the other deals, the pay-to-play deals with Hillary Clinton that should be investigated, legitimate questions that I have. I don't care if it was Hillary Clinton or anyone else. When you use your position of power, whether you're the president or Secretary of Defense or Secretary of State, and you personally profit from that, and the American public deserves to know that, and then let the courts decide how you should be prosecuted. Come on and give us that, because you have all those facts, meticulous scholarship you've done. We want to hear what you have to say in depth for a whole hour, just you.
Thank you, and I'll sign off.
Good. Charles Ortel, and you can go to charlesortel.com. I'm Gary Null. We're out of time. Thank you all for listening. Look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day.